So, how do you connect your computer to the internet? Normally, you plug it in or you connect it via Wi-Fi and some kind of DHCP kicks in, and your home router will assign it an IP address from your network, and you're gonna go working and see little kittens from the internet. How do you do the same stuff in the data center? In the data center, you have all your servers and connect them to the expensive switch that you bought, and you assign all the IP addresses one by one with, manually, and assign a default gateway, and then you're happy and all your machines are running. So, of course, your expensive switch in the data center, you also have some, I call them risks, and other call them features. You use port channels and aggregations, probably for more redundancy of your servers, and you're using VLANs to separate traffic a little bit. You're using spanning tree. Anyone had an outage because of a spanning tree reconverges in the middle of the night or so? So that's the reason why I call them risks. And if you take away these risks, it seems like you're making out of your expensive switch just a dump CPE device in the data center. And welcome to my talk, Operating OpenStack on an IP Fabric. My name is Jan Walzer. I'm a cloud architect for Innovo Cloud. And I will tell you why your expensive switches can do much more better. So a little agenda. What is an IP Fabric? Why are we doing that? How do we deploy this stuff? What does operations mean for such a thing, and why we are using Cumulus networks? So to recap a little bit, that's the setup. Normally, you have your servers and in your network, and every server gets assigned an IP address from the same IP network, and you are configuring, as I showed before, a default gateway. All the traffic goes through that default gateway and we are happy. Can we do better than that? There's a thing called routing, and we decided to leave all these layer 2 features out of the setup because we are using essentially an IP fabric. What we are doing is we are using two routers and connect each server to this router. And with small subnets. Terminology for that is we call these links transfer networks, as you can see, and we have a so-called canonical IP. The important stuff on that is these transfer networks are only small IP networks. They only have two IP addresses available because we only need two IP addresses in these networks because they only need to push packets from one node to the other node. And these IP addresses will never be used for any service in the network. That's the reason why we have this so-called canonical IP. That's the IP address we use for addressing a service on that server. And how do packets arrive at the server in the end? We are using a protocol called BGP. That's the protocol that the internet runs on. And we decided to have this protocol also running on every device in our network. So the servers and the switches are running BGP daemons. And they exchange all the routing informations between the devices. This means that the routers learn how they can reach the canonical IP of the server, and the server learns how to get out of the network or to other nodes. So if we add another node, you can see that the routing table is growing. This means the other machine learns about the canonical IP of the new server, and the new server learns also the route to the other server. And this can grow quite large. We can connect all our servers in the racks that way. So what we are currently going for is that we deploy blocks of two racks, full with two unit servers, which means in the end around 40 servers in two racks, which matches exactly our switches that we are using because they have 48 ports. We can put in every rack one of the switches and cross-connect all the servers to both switches and have one block completely. And all the information how packets have to go through the network are learned by this BGP protocol. So if we want to scale a bit larger, if we need more racks than two, we just put them next to each other and put some other switches atop of that. And they all, again, are running BGP. They all learn from each other which IPs are where in the network and how they can reach it. What we built here is a so-called spine leaf architecture. And this has some really nice properties. It gives us consistent performance between all the racks, consistent subscription ratios, and latency. Latency is really important. It's, as someone else called it before, the last boundary that we have still in IT, because we can't go low enough with latency. So also we can scale this performance and latency because we just put more switches or more links to the setup, and it will scale. And this is an architecture that's made for current data centers where we have the whole east-west traffic where servers talk to each other and not the old fashion where all the servers had to go out to the internet or someone else where we had this north-south traffic. Nowadays we have mostly east-west traffic. The thing is called a Kloss network after Charles Kloss, who studied these networks in the range of telco networking in around 1952. And there's a really nice article in Wikipedia. You can read about that stuff. So that's an IP fabric and what we are doing. But why are we doing that? There are three main points for us that make this important. That's the operational flexibility, the redundancy and resilience, and scalability. And what do I mean with operational flexibility? With this feature of BGP and learning which IP is where in the network, every IP that we are using for a service can be moved to every other point in our whole cluster and setup instantly. If you want to move an IP or a service over to a different data center, you normally have problems. You get a penalty because you don't have the same IP subnets over there, or you have a layer 2 connectivity between data centers, and this will get you in completely different troubles. So we have the flexibility. We have also redundancy and resilience because we are avoiding all the layer 2 issues I mentioned at the beginning. And if we have some issues at layer 2, these issues are isolated, because these faults are isolated because our layer 2 segment is only between a host and a switch, or between two switches. We don't have large layer 2 networks. That's really an important point. What we also get automatically is multipathing. Multipathing, in this case equal cost multipathing, is given because the routers can do the switching, the routing of the packets packet-wise or flow-based, and automatically will use all the available capacities and paths between the nodes. And what we also get as a gift is Anycast. Anycast means that I can bring up one IP address at multiple points in the same cluster in parallel. Which means if I put these IPs or these services strategically over my data centers, over my racks, I can do load balancing because the routers will try to deliver the packets to the nearest node that has this IP address. So that's what CDNs do at a global scale. We can do that in the data center, and if one, let's say, a DNS server in my data center fails, that means the IP goes down for that service, and the packet will also instantly go to a different DNS server and get replied there. So Anycast is a really cool feature. It does a load balancing in the data center without having a load balancer. And as I already mentioned, scalability, this design of the leaf and spine architecture will stay the same. I can just add more links or more switches or more racks or more data centers as I need it. The design of the whole fabric stays the same. That's a really important point on that. So how do we deploy that? We are using mainly two tools for that. We have a very important for that startup an IP management solution because we need one source of truth, and we have the paradigm of infrastructure as code. And for the IP management, we use the software NetBox, and it's configured with all the important data that we need to know. So IP addresses, networks that are allocated, service IPs, the transfer IP networks, the hosts themselves with classification, so we can tell in NetBox which service will happen on what host and how to configure it later, because the configuration for us works with Ansible and Ansible playbooks, which allows us to roll out all the changes without manual interaction. These playbooks are stored for us in a GitLab, so managing them with Git, and a CI toolchain checks for errors in the configuration. And what's the important thing here? We have server configs and switch configs are the same because we are running Cumulus Linux on our switches. Cumulus Linux, the guys are sitting over there at the booth, they are providing a Linux distribution for your switches, which is Debian-based, so you can log in to your switch and do a troubleshooting like you normally would on your server. You can roll out the same playbooks from your Ansible, you can do the same monitoring, you can do the same logging configuration. It's simply the same. And that's a real improvement because we don't have to manage so much special stuff. How does the operation for this whole thing work? We have the paradigm of everything is a metric, and we are doing metric-based monitoring, logging, and alerting. The logging stuff, you probably know Elasticsearch and Kibana, so everything we get on logs flows into the Elasticsearch database, and we have the front end of Kibana for that. That's nothing special. For monitoring, we are using the duality of Prometheus and Grafana. Prometheus, a really great time series database and querying tool. So we have millions of time series with a high granularity to store them. And we have Grafana as a tool for dashboards that can show us what's the issue currently and how to look at the services, how they deal. And the alerting then, of course, happens with Prometheus and the alert manager component of that. So the metrics generate events, the events can create alerts, and these alerts are handled then, and you can send them to different targets. If you need to alert, you can send out SMS, you can send out a Slack channel notification if something is happening, or you can make it call you late in the night if something's really broken. We try to avoid that because we only want to get notified or called out at night if something is really broken and not for some small notifications, because as I showed, our network, for example, is completely resilient. If one switch goes down, if a port goes down, that's no issue for us. We can leave the technicians at their well-deserved sleep and just alert in the morning, then there's something to do. So coming back to Cumulus, what makes Cumulus Linux so special for us? I think I mentioned it, but I have to put a really good slide on that. It's just a normal Linux server based on Debian Linux. It looks like a server with lots of network interfaces and nothing more. Deployment and configuration can be done with the same tools and you have for troubleshooting a regular Linux environment like your servers. And also the tools for monitoring, logging, and Prometheus and Elasticsearch. That's the same as you would work with a server. And so the special thing on Cumulus for us is the routers are nothing special anymore. They are just servers. That's the thing I want you to take home. And thank you. Are there questions? One question, my talk was about OpenStack. I didn't mention anything because OpenStack just works. It's just a server we deploy on the network. It's deployed the same way as you would with your normal network that you have already, but we have a faster network for that. Everything in the underlay, our storage solution, we are using Ceph for that. All the OpenStack services just get configured with other IPs than normally, but they can connect each other, find themselves, and the service works. So OpenStack is nothing special. Thank you. Excuse me? Yes? Do we have a mic? Do we have a mic?
I guess it's on. So by IP fabric, you mean class?
Excuse me?
By IP fabric, you mean class?
Yes.
They are used interchangeably?
Not really. CLOS is a little bit more than that, a CLOS network. But the idea of having multiple stages where your packets traverse through a point-to-point network is the idea of what CLOS studied. So it's not completely interchangeable. I would stay with the term IP fabric for that, if I understand your
spine
question.
Spine leaf or IP fabric are the same?
Excuse me?
Spine leaf or IP fabric are the same?
Spine leaf is also a kind of technology that says we have different hierarchies. And what we are doing is that in the spine leaf, you can do spine leaf also with layer 2 networking, but we are doing it completely on layer 3. So that's why we call it IP fabric and not network fabric or spine leaf architecture alone. So it's not exactly the same, but they are going in the same direction.
So they are also stacked like in spine leaf. IP fabric, it also means a stack of routers like in IP fabric, right?
IP fabric means that you are doing everything on layer 3 with IPs, the routing and the leaf spine architecture between the switches.
So leaf spine architecture between the switches, but the layer 3.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. Other questions? Yes? Wait for the macro.
My question is that you have an overlay transport.
A what?
Overlay. Like
an overlay network. Yes, of course. Of course, that's the point why it works so well. What we are losing with this IP fabric is broadcast functionality, to be honest. But nowadays, I see no reason to have or where I would need an broadcast domain like we did in layer 2 networking. So all the layer 2 stuff that's of course happening in the VM networks and they are on an overlay network. Currently we are using the plain open vSwitch, which means that all the nodes or the nodes care for that the VMs can reach each other by building VXLAN tunnels between the nodes. And from the outside or from the view of our fabric, these are just UDP connections between two server nodes. But inside it, it's a layer 2 network and all the VXLAN tunnels can be joined together. So that's nothing a problem for us. It just works. The overlay network takes care that all the VMs that are in 1/24 network can reach each other. And that thing is doing the broadcast stuff. But you don't see that in the underlay. And that makes it possible that VMs in different data centers can look at each other and have the feeling they are in the same layer 2 network. But from the bottom side, it looks to us just a VPN, an IP connection between two server nodes. Last question.
So a lot of deployment tools use VLANs for separating different.
We don't use VLANs.
No, but many do.
Yes.
So you might have a VLAN for your tenant network traffic tunnels. You might have one for API traffic.
Yes.
Storage traffic. So you don't have any separation.
No.
So how do you have any way of securing or segregating traffic between those different networks, different types of traffic?
So why would I need that? So there's one point of truth in that. Of course, the management traffic for the hosts themselves, IPMI traffic and so on, this goes through a separate network. But every other traffic we have is in the class of management traffic for managing the service itself. We call it the underlay. And we have enough capacity there to care about overloading. We are running this with Mellanox stuff at 2x25 gig for every node. So not even our Ceph nodes can currently saturate this. And all the other stuff is inside VMs or virtualized networks. And these are encapsulated. They are one layer higher in the overlay, so there is no traffic flow between the underlay and the overlay. If the overlay needs to go out to the internet, we have separate nodes, dedicated nodes, that have on the one side the access to the underlay, where it gets the traffic from the VXLAN tunnels, and it has dedicated network interfaces to our outside and border router, where the traffic to the internet goes out. So there is currently no way of traffic from the overlay passing into the underlay. And that's our kind of separating.
Okay. And the routing is completely flat. You can get from everywhere to anywhere.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.